Dreamscape presents Has the Tribulation Begun? Avoiding Confusion and Redeeming the Time in These Last Days by Amir Tsarfati. Narrated by the author. I dedicate this book to all the faithful followers and supporters of Behold Israel. You have stayed with me through so much. Even as the attacks have come one after another, you have remained standing with me as biblically grounded voices of sound mind, love, and power. You have rejected all the sensationalism bought into by those who lack wisdom, character, and discernment, and instead have chosen to submit yourself to the leading of Scripture only. I am blessed to have you as part of this ministry. Chapter 1. Has the Tribulation Begun? No. Calm down. Breathe deep. You heard me right. The tribulation has not begun. But Amir, look at the world around us. Political chaos, financial meltdowns, rampant immorality. Surely this must be the tribulation. No, it is not. The world is overheating in the summers and freezing in the winters. There are global pandemics and devastating earthquakes. There is war in Europe and constant conflict in the Middle East and Asia and all over the world. Technology has gotten to the point that they are starting to microchip people. Are you blind? It's true that without my glasses, my sight may be a bit iffy, but I am not blind. And the answer is still no. 100%, unequivocally, without a doubt, the tribulation has not begun. How can I be so confident? Quite simply, it's because my focus is not on the world, but in the Word. The Bible makes it clear that what we are experiencing now is a firecracker compared to the nuclear weapon of the tribulation. My advice for those who do not follow Jesus Christ is to enjoy the good times now. They're not going to last. There you go. You're welcome. You can relax once again. I recognize that from a literary standpoint, I have just committed a cardinal sin. In what might be a compositional record, I answered the propositional question of this entire work in the first word of the book. I solved the mystery before anyone even knew there had been a crime. It's like Agatha Christie or Arthur Conan Doyle beginning one of their great whodunit novels with a line, "The butler did it." I have just spoiler alerted the title of my book into oblivion. But before you stop listening to this audiobook with a contended, "Well, that was easy," let me tell you that there is a method to my madness. There are much deeper and more important issues at play here than simply the timing of the tribulation. Timing is the easy part. Certainly, I could have left the question, "Has the tribulation begun?" hanging throughout the entire book, building the suspense chapter by chapter, creating concern and fear in your minds. But that would just be sensationalism. I would be playing with your emotions. Easy questions demand easy answers. Here, the easy answer is no, the tribulation has not begun. In subsequent chapters, I will fill you in on why I can so adamantly make that statement, why it is so important to understand the tribulation, and how you can know that the tribulation has actually begun should you happen to still be around when it launches. There is one more, even greater goal for this book. Early in the life of the church in Thessaloniki, the people were asking much the same question that we are answering in this book. Rumors were circulating that the end-time scenario had kicked off. The members of this church did not know what to believe. That's when Paul stepped in, writing, "Now, brethren, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together to him, we ask you not to be soon shaken in mind or troubled, either by spirit or by word or by letter, as if from us, as though the day of Christ had come. 2 Thessalonians 2 verses 1 and 2. The apostle then proceeded to teach them and remind them of what he had said in the past, easing their troubled minds. When you're done with this audiobook, I want you to be able to do the exact same thing with your loved ones, your friends, your fellow church members, anyone who needs to be comforted with this truth. My goal is for you to be equipped to be able to explain to anyone why this cannot possibly be the tribulation, how they can know the signs that the actual tribulation has begun, and how they can ensure that they won't be around to experience it. It's not so bad. A primary theme through Paul's second letter to the Corinthians is perspective. He constantly returned to the idea that we need to look at the temporary nature of this life through the lens of eternity. In the fourth chapter, he wrote, "Our light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory, while we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal." 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 17 and 18. The apostle, who himself knew great suffering through his life, wrote that no matter what it is you are going through, it is really nothing when you look at it in God's big picture. That can be a jarring assertion to hear, particularly if you are dealing with a chronic issue. The woman with multiple sclerosis, the man with ALS, the young adult with cerebral palsy. Doubtless, your life feels like anything other than a light affliction. But Paul's encouragement is just wait and see what God has planned for you. When compared with the exceeding and eternal weight of the glory of God, experiencing the beauty and joy of being in His incomparable presence, the pain of these earthly days will seem like nothing. The opposite is true when it comes to the tribulation. Once those 7 years begin, the troubles of our current situation will also seem like light affliction. However, it will not be because life will become so much better. Instead, people will long for the tranquil days of mask mandates and government overreach and wars in countries not their own. Remember when the government closed all the businesses and shut down our churches? Oh, life was so much easier then. This is not to downplay anything that has been happening recently. These have been difficult times. This is particularly true for those of you in America. I am not from the United States, so I can speak as someone who is looking in from the outside. Those of you listening who are Americans have been raised expecting the ideals of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. You hold on to them as your birthright, your inalienable rights. And you say that you will fight to the death to maintain them. And up until now, you've done an excellent job of doing so. That's why everybody wants to come to America. Whether legally or illegally, the United States is the world's immigration capital. With 50.6 million foreign-born residents, you have over three times more than the second-place country. And with good reason, America is a great place to live. People don't risk their life or livelihood to leave their country and go to one that's worse. They go to a place that's a step up. they travel to a new land that will give more opportunity for themselves and for their children. So much of that is based on those American ideals of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. In Europe, people don't have those same ideals. In the Middle East, they're not part of our mindset. Go to Afghanistan to pursue your rights of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, and your head will be rolling down the aisles. In the rest of the world, we're used to government overreach. We expect our rights to occasionally get trampled on. We don't like it, but it's the nature of things. Now, you in America are experiencing this for the first time. You're saying, what's going on? They're changing the rules. They're going beyond their constitutional mandates. And the rest of us in the world are saying, welcome to the club, Yanks. And because I have the gift...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.